This is Macro Voices with hedge fund manager Erik Townsend, the free weekly financial podcast targeting professional finance, high net worth individuals, family offices, and other sophisticated investors. Macro Voices is all about the brightest minds in the world of finance and macroeconomics telling it like it is, bullish or bearish, no holds barred. Now, here are your hosts, Erik Townsend and Patrick Ceresna.
Macro Voices episode 133 was recorded on September 20th, 2018. I'm Erik Townsend. Our all-star fall lineup continues this week with everyone's favorite petroleum geologist, Art Berman, returning as this week's feature interview guest. Art will explain how the balance between comparative inventory and market price has shifted downward in the last 6 months and what he sees on the horizon for oil prices. Be sure to stay tuned for extended equity market coverage in our post-game segment after the feature interview, when Patrick and I will dive into another chart deck and look at what might be coming next for the stock market. We'll also have an update on our live event plans.
And I'm Patrick Ceresna. Now, Erik, last week we talked about the fact that if the dollar weakness was to persist, that we could really see that act as a risk on for the markets. And well, with a rip like we saw today in the S&P 500 heading up towards like 2940, it really feels like something new is afoot here on the upside. What's your thinking here on the S&P?
You know, the timing of this is so frustrating. I sat down last night, Patrick, and I made my comments for today's show, and I was going to say to everybody, this resistance at 2912 has been formidable, but I am making the prediction that we are on the hairy edge of breaking out, and when we do, we're going to at least 2930. And of course, the market beat me to it. That's exactly what happened today. So I'm a day late to make it, but I had the call right. The obvious question is, what happens next? And you know, I think that we are still headed higher before this is over. But the big caveat there, Charlie McGilligan is no slouch. And as he told us last week, late September is a time when historically you tend to get a pullback. So I don't know that it's straight up from here. I wouldn't be surprised if Charlie is right and there is a pullback that takes us back down. But, you know, I think we're headed up towards high 2900s to 3000. Markets love round numbers. You know, why not put in that 3000 print on the S&P? And I don't know that it's over there either, Patrick. I do think that we are in some kind of a topping formation. But as you know, Patrick, topping is a process, not a discrete event. And news flow can always change that process. So, you know, where is the top going to be? I don't know. I think we're coming there. I would be surprised if by the first of the year, if we haven't maybe put in a top, at least for some kind of significant correction, if not cyclical bear market. But I don't think there's any reason to say, okay, that's it, we're done. I think it looks to me like we're headed higher. Again, the caveat, as Charlie said, is maybe there's a pullback coming before that happens.
You know, Erik, I want to actually talk about this in a little more detail. I prepared a couple charts in that chart book for our post game after our interview with Art. And I really want to kind of go through some of these different scenarios on the S&P and the levels that everyone's got to be paying attention to. So we'll get back to that in the post game. With that said, let's move on to the US dollar index, because we've broken that 94 handle and that's really been a driver. But what's interesting to me is that it isn't actually a broad US dollar breakdown. It really is a euro currency break it. The euro and the British pound are breaking out on the upside. You're seeing almost no response in the yen. You're seeing no movement in the renminbi. It really is just a euro currency move here. But nonetheless, the dollar index is responding. And so we have a breakdown. What's your feeling on how this plays out here?
Well, there's actually two aspects to this. One, everything you just said is exactly right. But in addition to that, we just rolled over from the September to the December futures contract on dollar index futures. And we've talked about backwardation and how it works on other shows, so many of our listeners know this. If you don't, just trust me. 93.5 is the new 94. It doesn't mean that that 94 support level has changed or we've changed the opinion of where the level was. It's the same level that was 94 on the September chart, is 93.5 on the December chart, and it's because of backwardation in the term structure of dollar index futures. So really what we've said in the past about a close below 94 on a daily closing basis being reason for concern, 93.5 is the new number to watch, and that's where the reason for concern comes into play. Even though if that happens, Patrick, and this is a tough one for me because you know, I try to make my commentaries based on something that is objective, where I can explain a reason for my views. I got to just be honest and say, I got a feeling that there's going to be a head fake lower than that. And it's just a hunch, Patrick. I think we're headed below 93.5, maybe down to 93, to fake out. The markets love to fake out as many people as they can. Everybody would panic at that point. Oh, my God, that's it. The dollar is crashing. It's over from here. And then it ends up going the other way, just as so many people got faked out when we dropped down below 90, you know, whatever that was, 6 months, a year ago. And it turned out that it was a head fake. So I've kind of got a feeling that maybe a head fake lower than that is coming. In any case, 93.5 is the number to watch, and we'll see what happens. But I still think that from a fundamental standpoint, the dollar shortage view, which Jeff Snyder has described so well, is still what I'm favoring. And until the fundamentals change, I would be inclined not to be shorting the dollar here. Maybe it's not time to be aggressively long, because there is room for that head fake, but I would not be going short if there's a daily close below 93.5. I think that there maybe is a head fake coming that's going to fool everybody.
Well, you know, again, we have a chart we want to speak to in the post game about that, but I kind of like the idea of your head fake. But one thing that I kind of think about is, well, what if the head fake isn't just a short-term liquidity event, but rather even sustained distribution down to those kind of levels? Because that, to me, could really fuel that risk on through October if we have a dollar that's in the gutter. And I think that if the dollar was to suddenly reverse and start skyrocketing higher, then that would suddenly derail everything. So it'll be interesting to see how it plays out. I want to share some charts in the post game about that. But nonetheless, let's move on to crude oil, because again, we had some interesting inventory numbers. What happened this week?
Well, we had crude oil drawing down 2.1 million barrels on the EIA report. That was after kind of a false alarm from API, where they thought there was going to be a surprise build. Turned out to be a drawdown of 2.1 million barrels. Cushing, Oklahoma, drawing down 1.3 million barrels. We're getting back to that pattern, Patrick, of persistent weekly drawdowns in Cushing, Oklahoma inventory. And surprisingly, you know, when that was happening before, it was just causing those near-dated time spreads, the difference from 1 month's price to the next, to blow out to extreme proportions. We're not seeing the blowout in the time spreads that we were seeing before, even though the Cushing inventory has been pulled down to an even lower level. Gasoline drawing down 1.7 million barrels, distillates building 839,000 barrels. So with the exception of distillates, drawdowns across the board. Obviously, that was bullish for oil prices. It didn't last, though, and I think that on Thursday morning, President Trump tweeting Saudi Arabia saying bring prices down probably put at least a damper on the rally. I don't know if that will last. I think we should probably save most of the rest of the price discussion about where crude oil is headed for Art Berman, because he's obviously our subject matter expert in this week's feature interview.
All right, Eric, let's move on to gold, because gold bullion, it's staying above 1,200. I mean, it seems to have based here. You know, when we look at that dollar index, would think that the gold would be more responsive, and yet it's not. I wanted to give everyone an update on the on a chart in the post game in regards to how the gold price to yuan is trading. But nonetheless, for now, what's your thinking here on gold? Are we still going to get a retracement higher here?
Well, I think you just touched on it, Patrick, which is what we're seeing in the dollar index in terms of weakness that you would want to equate to a move up in gold. And it's like, hey, how come gold hasn't moved up even as the dollar's weakening? The dollar's weakening against the euro specifically. The dollar's not really weakening against other currencies. And as we've discussed quite a bit in past episodes of this program, the correlations, Patrick, that have been driving gold going back a year ago, it was really the Japanese yen. More recently, it's been the Chinese yuan, where that correlation has been the more important factor. So when you see a move down in the dollar index and you expect that to be a move up on gold, you have to qualify what's causing the dollar index weakness. And if it's isolated to the euro the way it is right now, that doesn't really produce the pop in gold. Still interesting, though, I think it speaks to the view that we've had about gold here, which is that even even with some weakness that it should have at least spooked a few traders into thinking it's time to pile into the gold trade, they're not doing it. So I think that it's still about the dollar, and it's mostly about the dollar's relationship to non-euro currencies. And I think that we've probably still got more downside in gold, but we're not going to see the momentum pick up to the downside below 1,200, which has been a key support level, until we see the dollar recovering in a way that everybody can believe in. And as long as we've got this euro strength impairing the dollar index, it's hard for anybody to get super bearish on gold either. So I think gold's going to continue to consolidate here and then probably move lower as the dollar starts to recover on the dollar index. Now, of course, if I'm wrong about the dollar and the dollar tanks and it's all over, and not just the euro, but other currency pairs with the dollar show that to be the case, then perhaps the bottom is in for gold and it's all uphill from here. But I don't think so, Patrick. I think we've still got a ways to go. Now, to be clear, I definitely think gold will have its day in the sun, because at some point, not straight away, I think into next year, if not later, we're going to get to the point where this crazy market that's been built up with easy money policy from central banks for the last 10 years, where we have dramatically inflated prices of both stocks and bonds, we're going to get to where stocks and bonds are both selling off together, which is unusual. At least that's my prediction. If I'm right about that, and that happens, it's going to be a field day for gold investors to the upside. And it's mostly about when bonds are no longer acting as an effective safe haven and people start turning more and more to gold. Now, most institutional investors can't do that. They have to use treasury bonds as their safety trade asset. But other investors can look to gold as an alternative. And I think that when we get a systemic bond market sell-off, I don't think it's even about the stock market, it's about the bond market sell-off, that's where I think gold is going to potentially move into positive correlation with the U.S. dollar and move higher. It's a story that I think is still 6 to 12 months out, though.
Let's move on to treasury bonds, because June, July, August, 3 months, we stayed on the 10-year between 280 to 3%. And suddenly, in the last 3 days, three sustained breaks higher. I think we printed as high as 310 on that yield. Is this breakout for real? Are we finally getting a direction that is developed, or are you still thinking that this is a fake out?
Well, to be sure, we are seeing something going on here, and I would remind our listeners of the comment that I've made for the last couple of weeks, which is, hey, right now, this time of year, it's time to watch carefully and see what happens, because this is the time of year, seasonality-wise, when things start to really happen and major moves in markets start to take shape. But the caveat is, that doesn't mean that what you're seeing here is a head fake. The reason they call resistance levels is because that's the number that the market tends to go to and then reverse direction and go the other way. That key level is either 310 or 312 or 314, depending on exactly who's measuring it. It's right there, but somewhere between 310 and 314 on the 10-year yield. And we just barely touched 310. Now we're back down to 307 on Thursday afternoon. So far, that resistance is holding. It doesn't mean it's time to panic quite yet, but it does mean it's time to pay very close attention to what comes next. If we see daily closes above 3.10, and particularly above 3.14 on the 10-year yield, that really is a sign that maybe we have a directional move in play, and I wouldn't be surprised to see the trend accelerate from there. The thing is, we haven't seen that yet. We're on the hairy edge of it, and that's where markets tend to fake people out. So we've got to wait it out and see. Meanwhile, I want to mention, we normally talk about the 10-year, but Julian Brigden, one of our most popular guests on the program, has made the prediction that it's actually 3.25 on the 30-year treasury is the number that he's watching most closely, because you can make a very strong technical analysis argument that if you were to see a closing print on the month, not just on the day, but if we got to the end of September and we see a closing print above 3.25, that really means that there is a signal of a trend change for a trend that's been in play since the mid-1980s. It is a secular reversal in the direction direction of interest rates. And again, the caveat is the way these things work is markets love to take you right to that critical level, fake everybody out, get them to jump too soon, and then the market reverses in the other direction. So we could just be seeing a test of that critical level that is not going to hold, and we're, you know, maybe we're about to go big into the opposite direction, head below 2.60 on the 10-year yield. But right now, we're teetering on the edge of a breakout on both the 10-year and the 30-year, and if that is confirmed, it's a really, really big deal. So it's time to watch and time to watch carefully.
Eric, thanks for the market update. Now, this week's featured interview guest is petroleum geologist Art Berman. Eric's interview with Art is coming up as Macro Voices continues right here at macrovoices.com.
And now with this week's special guest, here's hedge fund manager Erik Townsend.
Joining me next is petroleum geologist Art Berman. And as always, Art has prepared one of his fantastic slide decks for us. Listeners, you can find the download link in your research roundup email. If you're not registered yet, just go to Art's picture on our homepage. And next to that, you'll find a link where you can obtain the downloads. Art, it's been way too long since we've had you on the program, and because of that, since we have a lot of new listeners, let's do a quick review of a subject that we've explained in your past interviews, which is this idea of comparative inventory. A lot of people in the oil market look at the weekly inventory reports from EIA, and they just look at that number without adjusting it. Explain why you use comparative inventory, what it's all about, and maybe you can relate that to the graphs you have on slide 2 in your deck.
Well, Eric, it's really great to be back, and thanks for inviting me. And comparative inventory is a very simple concept. Let me explain it briefly. What we do is we simply take the current storage level and subtract the five-year average from it, and that's it. Why is this important? As you said, you know, people look at the raw numbers, and the raw numbers are interesting, but the key is not to relate the change in storage to what happened last week or 2 weeks ago, but what happened on this precise week over a period of time. And what that does is it normalizes out all the seasonal issues, the refinery maintenance issues, et cetera, et cetera. I've been using comparative inventory for a long time, and in my experience, it is absolutely, if you had to use only one tool, which would be crazy, comparative inventory is the most diagnostic tool to help you understand price trends and where those price trends might be going. So if that's not a good enough endorsement, I can't sell it any better than that. So looking at slide 2, I'm showing two simple charts. The one on the left simply illustrates the way comparative inventory works. And so in gold, we have absolute stock levels, inventories. In red below it is the five-year average, and the shaded area in blue is WTI price, because here, of course, we're using U.S. inventories. And so basically, you take the gold, the inventories, subtract the red, the five-year average, and bingo, you go to the right-hand graph, and that's the output. So you simply subtract those two curves. And as you can see in the left-hand graph, the red curve is above the gold curve on the left side. Move to the right graph, that equates to negative comparative inventory. The big build in inventory that we saw beginning in 2014, early 2015, that explains the oil price collapse, translates on the right-hand graph to the big yellow mountain. And then you can also see that beginning in March of this year, where the curves cross again on the left-hand graph, we move back into a comparative inventory deficit. So right there in its simplest form is what comparative inventory is all about. And as I said, the key is, to me, this explains price trends in the best possible way. So if anybody wants to understand why we got into oil price trouble a couple of years ago, look at the graph on the right. If anybody wants to understand why prices rose in the first half or so of 2018, look at the graph on the right. And so if we then take that same data, which is to say comparative inventory, and cross plot it with WTI price, which I've already shown you in the first graph on the left. So moving on to the next slide, which is slide 3, I'll expand that view and show you now the comparative inventory history going back to 2000 or so. And just for reference, again, you see the big Mount Everest of yellow or gold. That is what we were looking at on the previous graph. And so the point of this graph is to show that comparative inventory ordinarily correlates with price inversely. Okay, so when inventory is low, price is high, and when inventory is high, price is low, and that kind of makes sense. Except there are a few periods in history in which that has not been the case. And those are periods when the market doesn't care about how much oil is in storage. The market is deeply concerned about supply. And if you look at the circle on the first graph on the left, that's the period leading up to the financial collapse that we're coming off of low supply for several years. We've gotten into huge Asian, mostly Chinese demand. And the market says, you know what? We don't care if there's a storage surplus. We're concerned about prices. So we're going to drive the price higher, even though the storage keeps getting higher. Similarly, if you look back on the far left of that graph back in the late 1990s, we went into serious deficit. I mean, much more deficit than we're seeing right now. And yet the price response was very muted. And the reason is that back in the late 90s, the market said, you know, we don't really care. There seems to be so much oil in the world. Remember, prices were, you know, $18 a barrel in 2018 dollars. Market said, that's fine. So I bring this up not to try to cast doubt on the comparative inventory story, but to try to explain what's going on right now. So if we then move on to slide number 4, here I'm simply cross-plotting comparative inventory versus price. And so if we look at the graph on the left, I've selected three periods of history. I've selected the period in red from 2014 to the middle of last year. I've selected the current period from the middle of last year to right now in blue. And then I'm showing that funny period in the late 1990s, early 2000s, when the market didn't really seem to care how negative comparative inventory was. Price stayed pretty flat. And so what we see then, starting with the red curve, is coming into the oil price collapse, we follow that line, which is called the yield curve, down, and we see it intersected the price axis, the y-axis, at about $80 or $85. Well, that is the five-year average, is what that axis represents. It went all the way down to, you know, to the low 30s and 40s. And then we come back to the left, and all of a sudden, the trend deviated back in about July of 2017. And frankly, that surprised me. I thought we were going to go right back onto the same trend. But the market was saying, you know, as we approach that five-year average, we don't think we need $80 a barrel or whatever the correct price was, that intersection point. We think that producers have lowered costs enough, or that there's been enough deflation in the market, that supply can be maintained at a lower mid-cycle price. Mid-cycle is the name of that intersection. And then going back to the 1995 to 2004 price cycle in green, you see we got way, way into negative territory. And yet that green, dark green yield curve, it hardly went up at all because the market felt we had plenty of supply. So moving to the curve on the right now, this is just a blow up of the red and the blue. So we're looking at where we are currently. This is as of last week, but the inventory report this morning doesn't change it hardly at all. And so what this is saying is that whereas in 2014 at the same inventory level we're at right now, we probably would have been at, you know, something like $110 a barrel. Right now we're at 72. So that's a, you know, that's a 35% price devaluation relative to what we were seeing in June of 2014. So this is a really important fact, particularly as analysts and traders are speculating of, wow, you know, you think we're going to go back to $90 oil or $100 oil or, you know, whatever the price is. And what the comparative inventory yield curve is telling me anything's possible, but that's not what the curve is saying. That curve is saying that we're about as high as we're going to go unless the market changes its perception radically from where it's been now for 14 or 15 months.
Let me just ask you a question, Art, before we move on, which is, if I look at the red curve on the left or on the right, either one, and then I look at the blue curve, obviously something's changed. It used to be that when we got to the level of comparative inventory that we're at right now, the result was upwards of $100 in oil prices, and that's not the result anymore. I want to ask you about why that might be the case, and particularly it seems to me like a big change that's occurred about at the same time is the legalization of U.S. exports. I wonder if what's going on is while the overall supply-demand situation is not really what it was before, it looks like it in comparative inventory because now it's legal to export that U.S. oil. Is that a potential explanation for the way that the yield curve has moved from the red to the blue curve?
Well, Eric, that's a real good point you bring up, but no, that's not what I believe is happening there at all. Now, you had Chris Cook on MacroVoices not very long ago, and he talked about some of the regulation changes in how Saudi Arabia and some other companies price their oil for European markets. That's exactly when this happened. You know, I don't want to get into arguing the fine points of Chris's thesis, which I think, you know, bears attention. But something like that, you know, we see this on, you know, if you look at the commitment of traders charts, which I guess I'll show a little bit later, something happened there. But no, I don't think it was U.S. exports. And the reason that I don't think that is because that is one of many, many changes that have occurred over the 25 years of comparative inventory data. And usually it accommodates those things just fine. This is, you know, I'll show you in a little bit the OECD minus U.S. comparative inventory, and it shows exactly the same thing. I mean, storage is storage. Inventory is inventory. If you've got a deficit, you got a deficit and price goes up. I think that this change has everything to do mostly with the deflationary trend in oil and gas commodities, which is probably related as much as anything to the change in unconventional oil and gas production. It's also got to do with the fact that everything, at least for a while, was cheaper in oil field services. So everybody's cost of marginal production went down. U.S. exports are, you know, 1.5 million barrels a day on a weekly basis, which is important, but it doesn't change the dynamics of market balance that much. That's my view. So if we go on then to slide number 5, what I'm showing here is why I think that's happening, at least in gross aspect. So on the left, I'm showing U.S. tight oil rig count, horizontal tight oil only in blue. And then I'm showing WTI price in gold. And I've just lagged the price back 3 months because that's not only about the time it takes between a change in rig count when we actually see the change in production, which results in the change in price, but that's actually the correlation that works. And the importance of this chart, I'm showing $60 a barrel. And the key is that we went from 193 rigs at the bottom of oil prices in May of 2016 to 568 rigs by April of 18. I'm sorry. So we almost tripled the rig count with prices at less than $60 a barrel. And so why would the market not say the whole point of raising prices is to get producers to drill more? So the market is saying, gosh, we're getting all the response we need at prices below $60. Why should we have to pay any more? And then similarly, on the right-hand chart, here we're looking at tight oil U.S. production in blue. And again, that WTI price here, I've lagged it one more month just to account for some. Well, it takes a little bit longer to get those wells on production. And what we see here is that, yeah, living through this oil price collapse, it seemed like you know, production went way down. But the point of this graph is that tight oil production returned to pre-oil price collapse peak level at WTI prices of around $50. So if I look at these two charts, I say, why in the world do you think you need $100 oil prices to get the supply you want, assuming, of course, that U.S. tight oil production, you know, is the marginal barrel or the, you know, the swing producer or whatever kind of, you know, garbage term you want to throw at it. But it is the variable. It is what has changed in the world. It is where we're going to get our surplus from. So that's really compelling thing that's going on. If we then go to slide six, here we see the same thing going on in managed money net long positions that we did in the change in comparative inventory. Chart on the left, June 16th, 2017. Net long positions are at a very low level, and all of a sudden they start climbing. They climb to a peak in early 2018. Chart on the left is just WTI crude plus product net longs. Chart on the right is Brent plus WTI net long. Same thing. You've got a low in June of 2017. You go to a peak in January of 2018, and then it starts going down. So I look at these two graphs, and first of all, you know, I can't fully explain what happened in June 2016. Something big happened. More importantly to the present discussion, however, is that since the beginning of 2018, things have been going generally downhill. Traders have been unwinding long positions both on WTI and WTI plus Brent. We saw our maximum comparative inventory negative in early 2018, and it's been climbing back up again. So to me, I see the overall price trend. We've probably hit the highest price on average that we're going to see in this price cycle until and unless something fundamental changes. Looking at slide seven, you know, you talk, Eric, about U.S. exports. U.S. exports have been a very important release valve on U.S. inventories. The U.S. never stopped overproducing oil, okay? If the U.S. was one of the key parties responsible for the oil price collapse, as I showed on that earlier graph, we didn't really slow down very much at all. And we picked right back up, and now we're way past those earlier levels. So the reason that U.S. inventories have not started to build more quickly than they are right now is because we're exporting 1.5 million or 2 million barrels a day out of the country. But the important point that I want to make on this slide, slide seven, is I think that export party is starting to lose momentum. And what I'm showing then is distillates. Distillates, diesel, if you will. I mean, that is the big cash cow of U.S. refined product exports. And you could see distillate inventories, when they were going down and down and down, price was going up and up and up. If we look then, I mean, distillate is 17% of U.S. exports. If we look at the graph on the right, what it shows very clearly is that although distillate exports remain strong and they are above the five-year average, they've declined compared with the record levels in 2017. The reason for that, I think, is that some of our big takers of distillate, Mexico and Brazil, have started to build out their refineries and say, well, why should we pay your high prices? We can refine that stuff ourselves. So to me, that's another indication that, you know, maybe things have reached a peak as far as price and comparative inventory go, at least for a while. If we look at the next graphs in slide eight, here I'm just showing both distillate and gasoline inventories, and they're both building, okay? They were falling for a long time. As I said, distillate inventory is still below the five-year average, but it's at the highest level that it's been since the end of the first quarter. Okay, gasoline comparative inventory is well above the five-year average, and the difference between that five-year average and stock levels is widening. So right now we're in the destocking period for gasoline stocks, and yet we see the trend is that stocks are continuing to move away from the five-year average. So that's another kind of negative piece of evidence in this story I'm building.
Art, before we move off of this subject of U.S. exports, what the heck is going on with the Brent WTI spread, which has just been extraordinary in recent weeks? I've been completely baffled by that.
Right. And you've got that 100% correct, Eric, that premium of Brent to WTI has gone from 367 to 813 just in the last really couple of weeks. So, you know, that margin has, that differential has really expanded. And the way I interpret that is a reflection of market concerns about supply security close to the Middle East, which is to say Brent. Supply security for WTI, not so much concern. And so when the market perceives that there's a supply threat potentially out there on one versus the other, they're going to buy up those near-term contracts. So that's what I think is going on. And the other thing that I show in this slide number 9 is that, yeah, U.S. exports are, you know, they're still kicking butt, but not compared with where they were earlier this year. So we've fallen. We were up to 3 million barrels a day in April, but now we're down to something like 1.5 million. Last week was 1.6. So we've actually fallen below the year-to-date 2018 average. Now, don't get me wrong. I mean, that's still a lot of oil, and it's a whole lot more oil than we were exporting a couple of years ago. But remember, you know, this whole business of price, it's a razor's edge. You know, I'm starting to add up all kinds of little changes, maybe not so little, but a lot of changes in distillate and gasoline and in comparative inventory and commitment of traders and now in exports and Brent WTI spread. And it's all starting to add up to maybe oil price is not going to go so high. The other thing I'll mention before we move on, Eric, is that foreign refiners have started to understand the limitations of high API gravity U.S. crude oil. It's great stuff if you want low sulfur, but it makes crappy gasoline and you can't hardly use it at all to make diesel. Those are the two big products that the market's looking at, and the market has started to understand that there's kind of limited use for this stuff. So, and by the way, part, you know, this trade war that we've got now with China. China was, you know, the biggest buyer of U.S. exports, took over first place from Canada. So they're cutting back. So that all adds to the story.
Art, a topic we've talked about quite a bit on this program has been the bizarre behavior of time spreads in the WTI market. Now, if you go back a few months, there was a blowout to $3 a month at one point of difference between the price of WTI from one month to the next, and that was August to September and September to October. Now, as we're getting even deeper drawdowns in comparative inventory and inventory on an absolute basis is lower, you know, it seems like the problem's getting worse, but the backwardation is nowhere close to what it was a couple of months ago. I don't understand what's going on here. Why is backwardation seemingly collapsing on WTI when it was worse on WTI when the inventory numbers didn't seem to dictate it? It doesn't add up for me.
Right. So there are a couple of things going on here, and I'm not sure I can fully answer your question, Eric. But, you know, building on the point that I made earlier about the Brent premium to WTI, what I see going on here is that WTI and Brent are going completely in two different directions. So these two graphs on slide 10, this just shows the 6 months calendar spreads on both WTI and Brent. And it was real interesting because, you know, it wasn't but a couple of weeks ago that those Brent spreads actually went into contango. You know, we not only collapsed the backwardation, but we went the other direction. But all of a sudden, you know, in the last several weeks, those have turned around and the backwardation on Brent is increasing. Conversely, WTI, the two were moving in tandem. It just keeps going down. Last week, we were down. Those spreads were, you know, down from 777 to 99 cents, you know, a huge collapse. So I look at this simplistically as This is reflecting the two different worlds and how supply security is reflected in market price and in the way that people trade those things. So what's happening there is that if we're worried about Brent, we're buying the front and we're selling the tail, okay? And that increases the backwardation. If we're not so concerned with WTI from a supply security standpoint, we're kind of balancing the two. Maybe we're selling the front and buying the back, and so that backwardation collapses. I mean, I'm a geologist and I'm no expert on trading, but that's the simple way that I understand it.
Art, moving on to slide 11, needless to say, supply security has been a major issue with so much going on geopolitically around the world. What are these graphs on slide 11 showing us?
Eric, they're showing us on the graph on the left with all the pretty colors on it. This is the problem we all know about. These are the OPEC countries that are in trouble: Iran, Nigeria, Libya, and Venezuela. Iran sanctions have not even returned yet, and yet the production in those four countries has fallen 1 million barrels a day since January and 500,000 barrels a day just since May. So the output from those countries is falling off a cliff. Now, it came back a little bit in August, which was principally because Libya, that's a situation. It's a seesaw. It goes up and down. When they knock out a piece of a refinery or a pipeline, it goes way down. They fix it and it goes back up. But to me, Libya, Nigeria, they kind of move back and forth. Iran's going down. Venezuela is hopeless. So when the United States decided to pull out of the Iran deal, and of course Saudi Arabia was really pushing us, or we were pushing together to do that, to put added pressure on Iran, probably Saudi Arabia told the U.S., no problem, guys, we'll just crank up our production, we got all the spare capacity, we'll get our buddies in Kuwait and UAE to help us out, and everything will be fine. Well, the graph on the right shows that, that's not necessarily true. So nobody really knows what OPEC spare capacity is, but let me just be on the record here and say that I don't believe the kind of numbers that we see out of EIA and IEA of 2, 3, 4 million barrels a day. I just don't. It may be there, but it's not marketable crude. It's sour, it's heavy, or something like that. So what I've done here, I think that the effective spare capacity is all Saudi, Kuwait, and UAE. So this graph on the right shows those three countries' output, and then in gold, their rig count. And what we see is that that output reached a maximum just at the time that the production cuts were announced in late 2016. Is that true spare capacity? I don't have any idea. But that's the most those three countries have ever produced. So I'm saying for now, that's a benchmark or a proxy for spare capacity. So what we see is that about the time that, all these blowouts started happening that you talk about, when the Iran situation became critical, when Trump said we were probably pulling out of that deal, that nuclear deal, these three countries started cranking up production. And they have increased production more than 500,000 barrels a day since April. Well, that's the good news. The bad news is that if you believe that November 2016 number of almost 17 million barrels a day, we're just a couple of 100,000 barrels a day below that. So if you believe this chart, they're going, pedal to the metal right now, and they just don't have a lot more room to go. So this slide then shows, okay, so you've made a point, Art, that, maybe things have maxed out on price, but this chart says, boy, I see a lot of potential here for price going up. And I acknowledge that. And I've said supply security is a big deal. But I've also pointed out that we're not going to go back to the same pattern we were on in 2011, 12, 13, 14, that the market still thinks that it can be amply supplied at $60, $70, $80 a barrel. So that's the point there.
IEA and OPEC famously have very different perspectives on what's really going on in the marketplace. What's going on here in slide 12?
Yeah. So what I've done here is I've taken IEA's forecast for demand on the left and OPEC's forecast for demand on the right. Now, neither of those two agencies provides a supply forecast past the present quarter, but EIA does. And so I've developed a calibration algorithm which goes back and looks at how IEA and OPEC supply correlates with EIA production, plugged it in, and have gone forward, you know, with this forecast of supply-demand balance. We can talk about where the hair on that is, but it's the best we can do. What this shows is that the IEA model says that we have pretty much reached the point that I've described previously, which is to say that we were in deficit in 2017. We've been in balance for 2018. And hold on to your hats, guys, because in 2019, we're going to go into a pretty substantial oversupply, production surplus. Now, before anybody freaks out, I mean, it's nowhere near what we saw in 2015-16, but you know, it is pretty nearly a million barrels a day. So that's the IEA view of the future. The graph on the right is the OPEC view. The OPEC view says, we are going to continue in deficit through the end of 2018. We're going to max that supply-demand deficit in the fourth quarter. And then, similar to the IEA perspective, we're going to go into a supply surplus, which is going to be fairly substantial, certainly by the second half, and then we're going to go back into deficit. So, you know, I present these two graphs not to cast aspersions on the forecasting capabilities of these agencies, but, you know, is it any wonder that investors are confused? You look at the IEA and you say, oh my God, you know, we got a supply surplus coming. You look at the OPEC on the right and you say, well, yeah, we do. It's, you know, but it's not going to last very long. So we're torn. Do we want to be long on oil? Do we want to be short on oil? And that's kind of where the market is right now.
And what's your view in terms of, obviously, these are opposite predictions. Where do you think we're headed? It sounds like you think maybe the upside has run out of steam. Does that mean we're headed back down in price, or we're just moving into a consolidation range now?
Yeah, I think the latter, Eric. You know, anything's possible. I certainly don't know the future, and I try to put all the many moving parts together like we all do. My perspective, though, is I see probably more evidence on the downside to range-bound prices for both WTI and Brent than I do upside. I certainly see the upside. I completely get that. But again, I think when you're looking at it, you have to look at the big picture. And the big picture is the global economy for me.
Art, moving on to slide 13, the final slide in your deck, you know, you've given us all these different points of view between OPEC and IEA. What do you think is going to happen from here, and what are the driving factors going to be?
Well, that's the question everybody wants the answer to, Eric. But my sense is I see more evidence on the downside for oil price than I do on the upside. I completely understand the upside argument. I completely get why people are very bullish and think that oil prices could be $90 Brent, you know, $75, $70 WTI before the end of the year. And it wouldn't surprise me if they were, to be honest. But looking at all this evidence, I think the motivation towards higher prices makes sense, except when you add in all the other factors, the fact that we're really still in a deflationary cycle in the oil and gas market. It doesn't feel like it because we've come so far from $30 oil. But remember, I mean, oil field services prices are way down. The cost of producing the marginal barrel is way down for everybody, not just shale. The break-even prices on everybody are way down. So the market is looking at the big picture and saying, yeah, I think we do have tighter supply coming on the horizon. There is an issue about supply security, but that doesn't mean we need $90 oil or $100 oil to provide incentive to producers to produce more. that the market data says we got so much bang for our buck at less than $60. Why should the market pay anything more than what it's paying right now? I could be way wrong on that, but my sense is that we're probably going to see range-bound prices going forward until something fundamental changes. What do you say to all the people that say, yeah, but look at your graph, look at Iran, look at Venezuela, you know, look at all those problems? I'm saying I don't know how to answer that. Nobody does. But my sense is on Iran, this is a completely artificial supply crisis. It is something that was put into place because the U.S. decided and Saudi Arabia helped us decide that Iran needs to be punished. I don't want to get into the, you know, whether that's a right or wrong decision, but it's artificial, okay? We created that. It doesn't have to be. And my sense is first of all, you know, those guys in Iran are pretty clever. They're not going to get their exports 100% shut down. They're going to figure out ways through the black market, through accounting methods, you know, saying it's coming out of Iraq or something like that. And the other thing is that we are just getting started, the U.S. is, on granting sanction relief, okay? And the way that all of these aggressive hardline policies that have come out of the Trump administration, the way they've all gone is they get backpedaled. And in the end, it wouldn't surprise me if we gave a lot of dispensations and the impact on exports may not be as great as we fear. Or, you know, I don't know that, but I think that's a possibility. Like I said, Libya and Nigeria, they go up and down. Venezuela's already baked into things, okay? There's nothing that's going to happen there. So I look at all these factors together. Maybe OPEC's spare capacity is greater than I assume. I don't know. I'm using an empirical argument there. But again, I see we're in a period of secular deflation in oil prices that began in 2014, and I don't think we're out of it yet. You know, the tendency to think, okay, things are finally back to normal, we're going back to the world before 2014. I don't think we're ever going back to the world before 2014. So bottom line, Eric, I think that we're probably going to see prices range bound pretty much near where they are right now, possibly going below for the near term. And if either of those forecasts by OPEC or IEA are correct, looks like prices will go lower than whatever they end up at in 2018 and 2019. But as always, you know, nothing would completely surprise me.
Art, I agree with you in terms of where prices are probably headed. But there's one part of what you just said that makes me curious. You said you don't think they're ever going back to that pre-2014 level. It seems to me like, you know, peak oil was a very real thing. Now, people misjudged it because they thought it was going to happen on a global scale and prices were going to the roof. And the analysis that had been done was on conventional oil production. The thing is, that analysis was right on conventional oil production. Conventional oil peaked in 2005, hasn't exceeded that peak ever since, as far as I know. And the thing that everybody forgot to consider was that unconventional production totally outpaced it. It seems to me, and a lot of this is based on some of your own writings, at some point, I don't know when, but someday we get to the point where this shale thing has played out. The depletion rates in those wells are just so rapid compared to conventional production. It seems to me that when we get to that point where we've drilled up the countryside like Swiss cheese, there's no more fracking to do because we've used up all of these shale plays. And I realize that's not right away. But when that happens, it seems to me like really the longer term picture is everything else is in decline in conventional production, that peak oil thesis comes back into play, I would think, and we do get much, much higher prices. Am I missing something to think that?
No, Eric, you've got it correct. It's really a question of perspective and scaling, okay? So let me just say that, you know, what peak oil got right was peak price. That got nailed, all right? That was, you know, that was 2008 when price went to $147 a barrel for, you know, a day or a week or whatever it was. Where peak oil got it wrong, as you correctly said, was forever saying, well, we're just, you know, they weren't ignoring tight oil. They were just saying, well, you know, we're not talking about that. We're talking about conventional. But I think the real point of peak oil, the part that I take away as true and valid, is that peak oil is really about the end of cheap oil. Okay. And whatever you think about the longevity of shale plays, et cetera, there's just no doubt that even at the very low prices we've had for the last couple of years, the real constant dollar value of barrel of oil is 50% higher than it was at the beginning of the 2000s. So peak oil got that right too. And that's why I say peak price, that oil is definitely more expensive now than it used to be. There will be a moonshot, okay? I mean, there's going to come a time when you're right, that, you know, price is going to go way high just because we've used up, you know, all of these marginal shale productive wells. But the other factor that I think is real important here is the demand side. And I'm not talking about peak demand, okay? I mean, that's a whole other subject that I don't want to get into right now. But I mean, the reason that both of the IEA and OPEC forecasts talk about a surplus in 2019 is not just supply, it's demand. They're both showing weaker demand. And that's not based on an algorithm, you know, that I'm using on EIA. That's straight from IEA OPEC. Okay. Demand is weakening. Is it horribly weakened? No, but it's weaker than it has been. And you factor in this, you know, emerging market economy and higher interest rates. And you look at things like gasoline consumption in the United States, you know, the vehicle miles traveled just came out this week and it's actually going down. People are apparently choosing to buy less gasoline because of the price. I mean, we're at, you know, $2.90 or $2.92 a gallon. That appears to be a pressure point for a lot of people. The Federal Reserve report on, you know, kind of the state of the economy in 2017, that 40% of Americans don't have a spare $400 for an emergency. I mean, it's easy to forget the details, but so it's not like people are saying, okay, I'm not buying gasoline. Of course they got to buy gasoline. They're buying less. That's the point. And so I look at all these kind of larger factors that clearly get beyond oil fundamentals, but they're supported by the oil fundamentals. So you're right. There's no doubt that, you know, we're going to have a price crisis, but how long will it last? You know, it might last a year. It might last 18 months, but that'll crater the global economy, those kind of high prices. So there will be a rebalancing, which will occur. And when we come out of whatever that relatively short-term price crisis is, we're going to be in a low-price oil world again. So peak oil is right, you're right, and yet what I said before about not really ever going back to 2011-14, which is sustained $100, $110 prices for 4 years, I don't think we're going back there, Eric.
Art, your blog at artberman.com is probably, as far as I know, the best free resource that exists on the internet relative to oil markets. For people who may not be familiar with it, first of all, it's free, which is really amazing considering the content. It's always full of graphs and charts of the same quality of what we've seen in this deck. Tell people what they can expect to find there and also how they can follow your work more generally.
Right. Well, artberman.com, as you say, Eric, it's 100% free. I maybe I need my head examined for doing that, but that's the choice I've made for now. You know, you will have to register because we're trying to keep trolls and bots out of things. But I try to post something every couple of weeks that summarizes the kind of thing that we're talking about today. My Twitter feed is on my website, but that's at AEBerman12. And I put up lots and lots of graphs every day, have spirited discussions with smart people like you and other traders and refiners and analysts. So if you want to know what I'm thinking between artberman.com and at AEBerman12, that's the way to find me.
Well, Art, I can't thank you enough for another fantastic interview. We look forward to having you back on the show again sometime soon. Patrick Ceresna and I will be back as Macro Voices continues right here at macrovoices.com.
Macro Voices is a listener-driven program. please email requests for specific future interview guests to requests@macrovoices.com. You can email questions for the program to mailbag@macrovoices.com, and we'll answer them on the air from time to time in our mailbag segment. We also welcome your suggestions for how we can improve the program. Now, back to your hosts, Eric Townsend and Patrick Ceresna.
Eric, what a great interview with Art. You know, what's interesting for me was the fact that he's already seeing inventory builds and big supply coming on the markets here at these price levels where we have WTI give or take around 70 and Brent near 80. Yet we're seeing numbers that are starting to look like it was back in 2014. You know, what did you take away from the interview?
Well, I thought that the repricing of the yield curve, the balance point between inventory and price, is clearly got to be super important. And to summarize, I think Art's own view, you know, you can speculate as to what the cause of that might be, but it's hard to tell exactly. It's fascinating to me to just puzzle on, what is it that caused the market to revalue that balance point in the yield curve? The other thing in terms of where the price action is headed that it's not that I disagree with Art, just something that didn't really come up in this interview. He's saying, you know, it looks like maybe that price rally is over, and I agree with his analysis completely, but there's a really big caveat, which is we've never had this much activity in terms of named tropical storms in the tropics, and there is always that wild card event, Patrick, this time of year, where if you get a Category 4 hurricane come barreling through the Gulf of Mexico and hit a lot of producing assets in the Gulf, taking them offline for a few days, and then it hits the Houston area and there's a lot of flooding and so forth, that can have just a huge, huge impact to the upside in oil price. And it's a temporary function. It's a temporary event, but it's very real and it happens. So I would not be looking, despite Art's view, to short the oil market right here. On the other hand, if we did have that event where one of these storms caused a price spike to occur in crude oil prices, particularly if it's not just in the front month that's closing, but if that price anomaly extends into the next contract month after that, I would be looking at shorting there because I think Art's got the right story here. The big picture story is we're probably at an intermediate term top in this market. I don't want to short this price, but boy, if we got back up to 75, 76 bucks on a weather spike, I think that would be a tempting short.
All right. Well, we prepared a really fun chart book that I want to speak to in just a moment. But before we get into our extended equity coverage, can you give our listeners a quick update what we're thinking about our plans for the live events?
Sure. I want to keep this quick this week just so we don't bore our listeners that are not interested. But basically, we told you last week we really needed to take a survey, and then the survey broke. I don't know how this happened, but the survey was designed to skip over questions. So if you answered, yes, I'm interested in coming, it wasn't supposed to ask you the question that says, we're so sorry to hear that you don't want to come. How come? It didn't happen, and we had people saying, you know, I'm 99% positive. I'm definitely coming, and the survey asked them, we're sorry, you don't want to come, caused a lot of people to give up on the survey. We had to ditch that survey, scrap it completely, because the SurveyMonkey system doesn't let you change it after it's been used. So we had to throw that survey away and make a new one. Don't worry, if you put the time into completing the survey, we did very carefully read and take to heart your comments, but we have a new survey that is not broken. So anybody who hasn't yet, please go to macrovoices.com/survey, read the description of what we're considering there. It's changed a little bit from last week, as I'll mention, but it's more detail on that page. What we've gotten is some pushback from Europeans saying, hey, we really enjoyed flying all the way to Toronto, but you know, that was a little bit closer to East Coast. It wasn't so far from Europe. Vegas is a connecting flight. That's kind of tough for us. We have a question for you Europeans. It's on the new survey. How do you feel about Dallas? Yeah, it's almost as far as Vegas as the crow flies, but you've got a lot of nonstop flights from Europe. The reason we really like Dallas is we've got quite a few of our most popular speakers, including Art Berman, who live there. So it gives us the ability to put some really popular speakers at the event. Other considerations, Miami, I think, is what we would do to try to accommodate our European audience. It's impossible to do Miami in January. It's totally sold out. If we go that option, we're going to have to slip the date out a month or two to, say, March or April in order to accommodate that. Also looking at Atlanta specifically because there is such a big hub airport, there's nonstop flights to Atlanta from almost every place on Earth. The new survey asks you about cities. We don't have Atlanta on there, unfortunately, because that just came up today. But we are asking you about Dallas and Miami. We are starting to think that we'll do something a little bit more formidable because people in Vancouver have been asking us to do something more than just hang out and have a beer. Maybe we'll put together an event at a restaurant or something where we do some presentations. It's probably going to cost about $100, and it's going to get you into the Natural Resource Conference where we'll be speaking, and also to a Macro Voices event where we might have some speakers and party and some networking and so forth. We're still working on figuring that out. Meantime, we're thinking that we'll probably slip the dates in order to maybe accommodate a different city. A lot of people don't seem to like Las Vegas, but we want your continuing feedback. We will keep you updated as things progress, but please continue to email us, events@macrovoices.com. Let us know your preferences and your ideas, and please take our survey at macrovoices.com/survey. Patrick, moving right along, you put another fantastic chart book together. Listeners, you'll find the download link in your Research Roundup email, or if you're not registered yet, just go to macrovoices.com and look for the red button that says Looking for the Downloads. I see here, looking at page 2, that you've gone from a 4-hour chart that you've been using in our previous post-game chart decks to a daily chart. What's the story there, Patrick?
It just fit on the chart better. At this stage, we've already had such a prolonged move from that February and April bottom that it's worth just kind of looking at this in a little bit of a zoomed out shot on the traditional daily charts. Nonetheless, let's take a look at the chart book there. On page 2, I overlaid the original targets we had somewhere in the 2880 to 2940 levels. But I also added one additional measured target in the box, which actually measured a chunk of the 2017 rally to project out. And interestingly enough, some of these targets do push into that 2980 level. So we're starting to approach the 3000 upper target zones. But, you know, obviously we got a breakout. It may still follow through for another day or two. We'll be interested to see if a dealer gamma roll-off over the weekend really spurs a little bit of a throwback next week, but that's yet to be seen. But really, it's on page 3 that I wanted to talk about, and it's this idea that what would it look like if what we're currently in started to develop a topping formation into the end of the year. It's a narrative that both me and you share as an idea that could play out, and certainly Charlie shared with us last week a really interesting scenario where we have, you know, a step back here in September, and then we have a big performance grab coming in October that may push that market even towards 3,000, and then we have some sort of a tantrum event that kind of happens at the late October into November. And I sort of put it on so visually we can see that this is now sort of technically look what maybe we can argue oil's been doing for the last 3 months. And so to me, it'll be very interesting. Obviously, this is not necessarily a forecast, but rather it's just a template for us to kind of keep an eye on to see whether the price action is actually confirming that kind of move.
Well, Patrick, this diagram that you've shown on page 3 is exactly what I was kind of thinking of in my head when I was describing in the market wrap where I see things going. I think the direction's up. As Charlie said, you could see a significant pullback late September, early October, because seasonally that's what tends to happen. I don't think it's all over there. I think there's still a push higher. You know, is it one push that's a final top like you've got on this chart, or is there another down and another push up? And, you know, who knows? But I think we're in a topping process here, so I couldn't agree with you more. Moving on to the dollar index on page number 4, what are you telling us here?
I just really wanted to identify that while we were pointing out this big consolidation zone on the dollar index between 94 and 95 and looking for the break, when you put it into a traditional technical analysis format, a natural retracement from that April to August dollar rally that we saw, a natural retracement is as low as the kind of 92.5 to 94 level. And so really, while we are getting technical breakdowns of the dollar index, it still actually fits a lot of the criteria for a retracement. But really, the story of showing that retracement zone is actually moving on to chart five, because chart five, I think, tells us a better story. And here, what I'm showing is the euro US dollar cross. And what I added on here is the volume by price bars. And what it shows is that there is a huge series of volume nodes trading between the one spot, 115.50 to 117 level on the euro, and that there was a substantial amount of consolidation and trading that occurred in that. And today's breakout in the euro really is going to test whether or not we're going to get some sort of US dollar long cover and some squeeze on the euro. And if this breakout happens, we're looking for potential surges up towards, let's say, 119, maybe even 120 on a bit of a squeeze. And it's really this watching this euro and what happens here that I think drives it, because that dollar index is 58% weighted into the euro. So I think that this one chart is going to tell us what's going to happen with the dollar here in the next few days even.
Well, Patrick, going back to slide number four in your deck, your graph here really shines a lot of light on what I was thinking about the dollar as we discussed back in the market wrap. Because remember, I was saying, you know, I got a feeling here that there's more lower coming, and I just can't put my finger on it. As I look at this, you know, there's such an obvious head and shoulders pattern here. I don't think that it really is the end of the world and a major reversal. But if you look at that head and shoulders that's now broken the neckline in the last couple of days, it would target about the bottom of that retracement zone. And so I think that it makes perfect sense to expect the dollar index to sell off into the lower half of that retracement zone blue box that you've got here. And, you know, once that's played out, I think that my view from a fundamental basis is probably the rally resumes at that point. So this definitely sheds some light on the perspective that I had on that hunch that maybe there was a head fake lower coming before we moved higher. What's going on page six? You're switching back to the oil market, my own favorite market. What are you showing here?
The last thing I wanted to just quickly add on this, and it really kind of shows this idea that if this dollar consolidation happens, it doesn't have to be a fake out where it's just like exactly that, you know, 1 or 2 days or like a week. And the question really becomes, if this sustains itself for a good chunk of the October, it really does feed that narrative that Charlie shared with us, that the cyclicals could really roll up and retrace, and even the emerging markets and other sectors, because really, they've all been hammered by the strong dollar. So this period where the dollar is pulling back and there's this relief coming, that may mean a lot of these risk-on assets will actually potentially fuel the October rally.
You know, I couldn't agree more, Patrick, and I think that it fits so perfectly with Charlie McElligott's view from last week, which is, you know, we see maybe a little bit of risk off, but a strong rally in October. And as you say, you need to have some dollar weakness in order to allow that to happen. And that, you know, maybe I'm using the wrong word, if a head fake, but a move that is not a directional reversal, but something that is temporary in nature, that is a pullback, maybe is a better word than head fake, would perfectly fit into that scenario. And it would leave us at the end of the year, let's say in December, with the dollar rally resuming, and maybe the top is in at that point on the equity market.
You know, Eric, I could totally see something like that happening. Really, I think that we should first see whether or not that we have a bullish response to the October earnings and what levels that takes us and how the market responds. And then we could kind of fish around to see whether or not this thing has the legs to go to December. But I think right now we have a pretty good template for how things can play out here in the next 6 weeks. So let's see how it plays out. So I wanted to move on to chart six, though, because really what I have here was I just overlaid Brent oil and the chart for WTI. And really what I want to show is that most people that track the WTI chart and see like that head and shoulders kind of topping that we're seeing there, we can really identify how Brent really looks actually rather bullish. And it's actually approaching those key $80 levels along the upside, that if it breaks out, it may actually be a full new bull breakout on it that could surge Brent up higher. And that would certainly drag the the WTI with it. So I just really wanted to visually share the importance of this $80 level on Brent and likely what it would impact on WTI.
And I'll just add a comment to that, Patrick. I think that tomorrow, Friday, and early next week's action is going to be really telling, because you've got, from a political standpoint, two very strong and important signals in opposite directions. Saudi Arabia commenting publicly this week that they would be entirely comfortable with oil prices moving above $80. Big green light there to move higher. Then this morning, President Trump angrily tweeting at Saudi Arabia, get those oil prices down. I think that that leaves markets wondering. There have been times in the past when Saudi Arabia was extremely responsive to pressure from President Trump's tweets. Now, my feeling, Patrick, this is just my opinion, is that their apparent readiness to just take what the president says and act on it was because of circumstances that were prevailing at that time that maybe don't exist today. So is Saudi Arabia going to say, yeah, you can want that, but we still welcome higher prices? Or are they going to say, oh, well, as a courtesy to our relationship with President Trump, we're going to back off? I think that Saudi Arabia's next public statement is really going to be a big goose in one direction or the other for the oil market. Because if Saudi Arabia says, thank you, Mr. President, we'll take your tweet under consideration, but frankly, we don't care, I think that the market's going to move substantially higher on that news.
All right. Well, let's move on to chart number 7. And really, again, just a very quick update on where that correlation between gold and the Chinese renminbi stands. And what's amazing is while we keep talking about gold and dollar index correlation, well, it's just uncanny how right now gold is just tracking the renminbi. And I personally still don't really know and can't even rationalize why this is developing, and nor does it mean that this has to continue being the case. But so long as this correlation continues to stick like this, I think we should keep observing and seeing whether or not gold is being responsive to this particular currency pair.
Oh, I couldn't agree more, Patrick. And as we said in the market wrap, you know, this is where it's really been at. And before the yuan, it was the yen. It's not the euro that's been driving gold. And we have to understand that the dollar index is so, so impacted by the euro. So I think that if you're watching the dollar index, because we've been telling you that the dollar is what really is going to govern the gold price, you really should be looking at other pairs, not just the dollar index, but dollar yuan, dollar yen, and so forth, and particularly dollar yuan. I mean, just this chart speaks for itself in terms of how strong the correlation has been.
So, and finally, on chart 8, I just really wanted to touch on interest rates and what the market is pricing in for the Fed. So what I have here is the euro dollars, and I took the spread between the December 2018 and the December 2019 contracts. And what was interesting is we spent pretty much February through August with the spread being somewhere around 30, sometimes at the upper boundary of 40 basis points, which is more or less that the market was baking in about one and a half rate hikes for the Fed. What's interesting is that the bond traders made a very decisive call here in the last week, and I really can't figure out what has been the driver of it. But we had this sudden surge between last week and this week, shooting this up to now 50 basis points. Basically, I take it away that it's they're pretty much banking in two rate hikes now next year, which is a very hawkish Fed. And I don't know if I have a full explanation for it, but it's certainly worth observing that the market is actually pricing in that Powell is going to just keep going here. I'm curious what will actually happen. What's your take on this?
I think it is so critical, as you say, and it's also very important to our discussion of what's happening with bond yields. The way that the market perceives the Fed policy is just so important, and I don't think it's super clear. I think the market is trying to feel it out and right now leaning toward a hawkish interpretation. So it's going to be, as you say, very interesting to see how it plays out. Meanwhile, Patrick, I want to move on to slide 9 in your deck. You know, as I was going through the survey responses for our live event that we're planning, One of the comments that I got from one of our listeners is, boy, he said, you know, I don't really care how you organize it. I just want to spend as much time as I possibly can looking over Patrick's shoulder and seeing how he does all this option stuff. It makes me wonder, Patrick, if people realize what business you're in, because they can look not only over your shoulder, but they can receive basically a detailed daily briefing from you, which you provide as one of the services that you offer to your big picture trading clients. So for some of our newer listeners who may not be familiar with what you do at Big Picture Trading, how about giving us a little bit of an introduction to what you do there, what the service involves, and how people can get a free trial, which I believe this is an honest-to-God free trial. None of the business about give us your credit card first. It's no kidding, no obligation, no credit card, no payment required, just a free pass. Tell us what's going on here.
What I do for my paying members is I essentially get onto a webinar every single morning, Monday through Thursday, analyze the markets. Very similar to the way we talk about the market during this podcast. I get on there and I show the charts and I look at where all the setups are and what we're doing. And then we talk about where we're going to do trade implementations. We do that all real time during the webinar, and it's posted as a recording. And then we send a weekly summary to our members. And then, of course, I have educational programs that really bridge the gap. Those people that don't know how have issues with implementation or how to put on the options trades. We have different master's programs to actually educate them to fill those gaps so that they can actually train themselves to make good money.
So for the listener who wanted to get as much options training from Patrick as he possibly could at the live event, sir, if you're listening, you don't need to wait for the live event. You can sign up for the Options Masterclass at Big Picture Trading and get that education anytime you want. On that note, Patrick, we need to leave it there and wrap the show up. So folks, we sure could use your help promoting Macro Voices. Please forward your research roundup emails, tell your friends and colleagues, and most importantly, register your free account at MacroVoices.com. Doesn't cost you a penny, only takes a few minutes. The benefit to you is you'll receive our free research roundup email, which never contains any advertising or marketing. It's just a compendium of links to all of the best content that we could find on the internet each week. Patrick, tell them what's in this week's research roundup.
Okay, well, you're going to find the transcript for today's interview with Art. So everyone that wants to go and actually look at the text and absorb what Art's views were, that is available as well. The chart book that accompanied Art's interview is also available for all of you to accompany listening to this session. As well, there's an article from Bob Pisani at Trader Talk, who basically wrote a piece talking about the rumor that the buyback blackouts means weak stocks. No, in fact, not really. And he kind of goes into explaining how companies buy back stock and what it really means to go into the blackout period. You'll also find an interesting YouTube video from our Macro Voices alumni, Steve Keen, who talks about the U.S. heading for a recession in 2020. So it's a great little YouTube video that's on there. You'll find this and so much more in this week's Research Roundup. That does it for this week's episode. We appreciate all the feedback and support we get from our listeners, and we're always looking for suggestions on how we can make the program even better. Now, for those of our listeners that write or blog about the market and would like to share that content with our listeners, send us an email at researchroundup@macrovoices.com or tag it with the MVRR hashtag on Twitter, and we'll include it in our weekly distributions. If you have not already, follow our main Twitter account at MacroVoices for all the most recent updates and releases. You can also follow Eric on Twitter at Eric S. Townsend and myself at Patrick Ceresna. On behalf of Eric Townsend and myself, thank you for listening, and we'll see you all next week.
That concludes this edition of Macro Voices. Be sure to tune in each week to hear feature interviews with the brightest minds in finance and macroeconomics. Macro Voices is made possible by sponsorship from BigPictureTrading.com, the Internet's premier source of online education for traders. Please visit BigPictureTrading.com for more information. Please register your free account at MacroVoices.com. Once registered, you'll receive our free weekly Research Roundup email containing links to supporting documents from our featured guests and the very best free financial content our volunteer research team could find on the internet each week. You'll also gain access to our free listener discussion forums and research library. And the more registered users we have, the more we'll be able to recruit high-profile feature interview guests for future programs. So please register your free account today at macrovoices.com if you haven't already. You can subscribe to Macro Voices on iTunes to have Macro Voices automatically delivered to your mobile device each week free of charge. You can email questions for the program to mailbag@macrovoices.com, and we'll answer your questions on the air from time to time in our mailbag segment. Macro Voices is presented for informational and entertainment purposes only. The information presented on Macro Voices should not be construed as investment advice. Always consult a licensed investment professional before making investment decisions. The views and opinions expressed on Macro Voices are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of the show's hosts or sponsors. Macro Voices, its producers, sponsors, and hosts Erik Townsend and Patrick Ceresna shall not be liable for losses resulting from investment decisions based on information or viewpoints presented on Macro Voices. Macro Voices is made possible by sponsorship from BigPictureTrading.com and by funding from Fourth Turning Capital Management, LLC. For more information, visit MacroVoices.com.